I mean, it is. I don't preach a lot on it, but it's all going to happen, and it is going to be. It'll be the worst nightmare ever. But we are living in some incredible days. Hebrews in your Bible. Look at chapter 3, and then we're just going to read a couple verses here, and then a couple of verses chapter 12. But if you look at Hebrews chapter 3, let's stand for a moment as we read the scriptures. If you need to slip out, now would be a good moment. I'll read, pray, and then we'll sit for 3.5 hours while I preach. No, I didn't get breakfast, so it ain't going to be no long sermon today, okay? I got one donut in Sunday school and a piece of cheese, but yeah, thank you for feeling bad, Mrs. Miller. I'm needing to go slaughter an ox. Hebrews 3:1. Follow along as I read. Wherefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider. We're supposed to consider the apostle and high priest of our profession, Jesus Christ, who was faithful to him that appointed him, as also Moses was faithful in all his house. For this man was counted worthy. We could just stop right there if you wanted to. He's counted worthy. Worthy of more glory than Moses, inasmuch as he hath builded the house, hath more honor than the house. This morning, I want us to consider. Think about the Lord Jesus Christ. Look over, if you would, to a couple of pages to chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 12, and down at verse 3. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 3. For consider him. Consider him that endured such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest you be wearied and faint in your minds. Now, there's some Christians in this room this morning, you will grow weary. Weary of the Christian life, weary of life, weary. And a year, 5 years, 10 years from now, you will look back and think, how did I get out of church? How did I get away from God? How did this happen? Now, my wife and I met a young lady this week. She grew up here, and then her family moved. And they moved back to the area, and she's working at a restaurant we were at, and we got talking to her. And I thought, boy, you don't want to risk, parents, don't risk getting your kids out of church. Consider. He endured some real rough times, such contradiction of sinners, lest you be weary and faint in your mind. Let's pray. Lord, help us these moments as we look at the Bible, as I try, to consider, help us to consider the apostle and high priest of our profession, to consider him that endured such contradiction of sinners against himself. All that Jesus put up with, all the garbage, all of the attitude, all of the harassment, and he pressed on and did what his Father asked him to do. Thank you for a Savior. May we consider him this morning. Help us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated. We're going to look at Hebrews 3 just for a moment. And most of my message today is going to be scripture that you're aware of, scripture that you have, really things that you know. But I want you to think with me for a minute. And got this silly brace on my knee. I thought about taking it off and throwing it into the crowd, yelling, I've been healed. And then fall down and say, well, maybe not. There's a great joke about that, but I don't want to do that today because it's making fun of people. Not people with crippling issues, but it's a lying evangelist. But anyway, you know, the song in our hymnal, one of my favorites, O come, let us adore him. That word adore is almost out of our vocabulary. To adoration. It's just about gone, and today I would like us to consider him and to urge you to adore him. You think about Jesus. He demands nothing from you to save you. Put your faith in him, trust him, and he'll save you. Simple as that. You don't have to count beads. You don't have to go to a Baptist church. You don't have to stand on a street corner with Watchtower magazines. Trust him. It's all. You think about the number of things religion has invented that are not anywhere in the Bible. It's amazing. You know, where are candles in the Bible? Where is the worship of Mary in the Bible? You know, the Buddhist religion, Buddhist people are very humble, gracious people, but they're lost as a termite in a yo-yo. Only problem is they don't make wooden yo-yos anymore. Hey, Buddha died. The rascal walked out on his wife. We call that lazy, no-account sluggards. He should have starved to death. Merry Christmas, just a thought there. Oh, just think with me. He demands nothing to save you. But he demanded everything of himself. You say, what's it going to take to get saved? Just leave it to me, Jesus said. I'll take care of it. Every word of prophetic statement out of our Bible from our Savior, every word has come true. Everything. Jesus prophesied the place he'd be born. He prophesied the family he'd be born in. He prophesied he would be crucified in Psalm 22. And he prophesied who would crucify him. Mighty bulls of Bashan out of Psalm 22. Jesus prophesied where his burial, that who he would die with on the cross and who he would be, whose tomb he'd be buried with. Everything about our Savior's world was prophetically proclaimed hundreds of years before it happened, and then people call Muhammad a prophet. He never prophesied nothing. He was a child molesting fornicator who had dozens of wives, the youngest around 12 or 14. And they weren't there by choice, I guarantee you that. Say, are you against Islamic people, Muslims? No, they need to get saved like I needed to get saved. But Jesus, thank you, Siri. He's wanting me to find out about Muhammad. Shh. That's a demonic apple, and it's from hell. They crucified him. They killed him. Hey, where are the bodies of the great prophets today? And where's the body of our Savior? He rose from the dead. Spent a month hanging out, talking with his friends. Over 500 people saw him at one time. He preached and taught and said, hey, I got to do something. I'll come back and see you later. That's a Savior. Oh, come, let us adore him. Jesus had no servants, but they called him master. He had no college degree, but they called him teacher. He possessed no medicines, and yet he healed every single sick person that crossed his path. Jesus had no army to command, and yet the rulers of the nation were terrified of him, so much so they killed him. Jesus was in no military battles, and yet he conquered more of the world than anyone could ever imagine. As the gospel message traveled around the world, our Savior had no house to live in. The Bible says Jesus said, the foxes have holes and the birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man, he said, I have nowhere to lay my head. And yet he was the ruler and Lord over multitudes. He had no political office, and yet they called him king. Jesus openly asked people, which of you convinceth me of sin? Who has ever seen me sin? Nobody had an answer. And yet they punished him like a criminal and gave him the death penalty. Though they buried him and put guards at his tomb, 3 days later, he rose from the dead and then thought, well, no one's going to know I'm out of here. We better open the rocks up to you. I love that he's already gone. And then the angel had to come and say, hey, you, look in here. And the stone rolled away. What a Savior. He offered mercy and forgiveness to fallen and broken people. Yet he found no mercy from anyone in his world. Although he had no earthly possessions, he was the richest ruler in the history of the universe. He had no great physical power, yet through his name millions found strength to face crucifixion and suffering beyond words and to sing as they faced those things. In his earthly body, he didn't appear strong, and yet he gave strength to people to do his will. Though he was slandered and horribly treated as a criminal, there are more songs written about him. Crucified unjustly, hated unjustly, despised and rejected, and he bore our sins. And yet, in this hymnal alone, over 500 songs about him. You've all seen the hymnals about Buddha, right? You ever see the hymnal about Muhammad? You know, there ain't any. Because we have a Savior that loves us. And this is just one hymnal. There's dozens of hymnals. You know, we've heard the joyful sound. Allah saves, Allah saves. Jesus. Jesus is the name. What a Savior we have. Hey, how can somebody so hated create such love and devotion in so many people? Why would young people all over the world, young people like these young people like these up here, why would these young people walk away from careers and opportunities and the most prosperous nation in the world and say, let me go live in a third world country for the name of Jesus? What a Savior. What a Savior we serve. He was described as a lamb dumb before his shears. He didn't open his mouth in his own defense, but when they came to him to arrest him, his words were so powerful, everybody fell down. We who are worthy of death received life. And the one who deserved life found death. What a Savior. He said that he would profess your name if you're saved. He said he would proclaim your name before the angels of God in heaven, while we are ashamed to profess his name before men. Societies outlawed his book, while he said, I have a book in heaven called the Book of Remembrance. And while you're embarrassed to have a Bible in the school, and while you outlaw my book in your world, I've got a book in heaven I'm writing down every time the people of God gather together. He calls it a Book of Remembrance. He knows when you get together. Someone says, I can be as close to God in the golf course as I can at church. Yeah, but he ain't writing it down. He isn't writing your par down on his book. You know how much he loves us for how little we love him? What a Savior. That he cares about you. The moment you get saved, yesterday I was talking to a guy, maybe 30 years old, sharp businessman, and he trusted Christ. And you know, the moment he bowed his head to put his faith in Christ, God or some angels up in heaven writing his name in the book of life. What a God. Question is, what in the world does he love us for? The Holy Spirit continues to draw people to Christ while mankind continually refuses his message of forgiveness. If you've witnessed to many people, how many people refuse the gospel compared to those who receive it? And yet God keeps saying, hey, if 100 people say no and one says yes, oh, isn't it great? Remember on the cross, Jesus there, one thief on this side, one on this side, they're murderers and thieves. The one guy says to Jesus, if you're who you say you are, get us out of this. Now at that point, I'd have just got off the cross and put all my nails on him. You remember what Jesus said to that first thief? No. He didn't even acknowledge him. The second thief says to the first thief, don't you realize we're in the same condemnation, and we indeed justly, we deserve that what we're getting. He's done nothing amiss. And he looked to Jesus and said, Lord, remember me. You know, Jesus didn't even talk to this guy over here. I hate to say it this way, but he didn't care. But he said to this man, equally guilty with that guy, he said to this man, today thou shalt be with me in paradise. You know, God's not worried about the 100 who don't hear. He is very concerned about the one who will hear. You young people that rode a bus today and parents didn't get you up and you got up on your own and got ready on your own, you came to church and to Sunday school on your own, God's up in heaven saying, yeah, there's 4,000 kids at the public school, but you know what? You're the one I'm interested in. You're the one that matters to me. And you may be the only one in your home that goes to church. You may come without your husband or without your wife, and you may come without your parents, but let me tell you something. You're the one that matters to me. He was unwelcomed in a foul and depraved world. And yet, he opens the gates of heaven for sinners to enter into his perfect kingdom. Why would a perfect God and a perfect Savior welcome sinners into his house when we don't hardly attend his house at earth? Man, up in heaven, you know, there's all kinds of songs and poetry. There's all kinds of craziness, you know, jokes. You know, you got to the gate, and there's St. Peter, and he says, why should you let me in? He ain't going to be at the gate. There's angels at the gate if you read your Bible. And I've already got, look, my name is on a reservation. Nobody's asking me. I'd say, what are you doing here? I got here the same way you did, by the blood, buddy. I live here. That's my home. Jesus is eternally devoted to you. He says in Hebrews, I'll never leave thee nor forsake thee. He is eternally devoted to you. He loves you with an everlasting love. While Christians drift away from him because something bad happened to him, or people at church didn't appreciate him, or they just get tired. Yeah, Jesus never got tired. The Lord promised he'd never leave you. And yet believers quit on God and quit on church all the time. See, if I were to quit on church because somebody in the church hurt my feelings, I'd have quit a long time ago. I'm here for him because he'll never let me down. But he looks at me, he's never going to let me down. And he's never going to leave me. He's never going to forsake me. And though the whole world despises me, he still loves me. He says, I've loved you with an everlasting love. What a Savior we have. And there's no reason for him to love us. We get so arrogant. My child plays the piano. Well, my daughter, she's the best football kicker. Whatever. My boy holds the world's record in girls boxing. My Savior made the stars, called them all by name. See, Jesus will allow frail and temporal men and women to wear a crown on earth. Think of all the kings and queens that wore crowns. And Jesus, he got a crown of thorns. He allows earthly monarchs to sit on the thrones. Can you just picture God looking at Kamala Harris? And if we'd have elected her, God would have let her have the most powerful seat in the world. I wouldn't have. I'd turn them all into frogs. If you graduated with a law degree, just practice your ribbit. Get out of all of them, get out of there. Think of the people, Bloody Mary, guilty of thousands of murders. And you think of the Hitlers and the Stalins and the Lenins and the Mao Zedong and the people. And God let all these punks, all these little chunks of earthly trash. And they all thought they were so big. And one day, they're going to fall on their face before Jesus. And the king will get the glory he deserves. I love, some of you aren't old enough to remember Madeline Murray O'Hare, but I can hardly wait till she calls Jesus Lord. What a great day that'll be. You know, the people who deny the Bible and deny that there's a heaven and deny that there's a God, I'm excited about getting to heaven. I'm excited to see Jesus. I'm excited to see my friends and family that have gone before me. I'm excited to see the city, but I'm really excited to see the God deniers. Well, was I ever wrong? Well, and you were more than wrong. But God allows these earthly monarchs. Why would he allow these arrogant athletes? You know, they make their touchdown, do their dance, do the twist, the bump, and the bunny hop, and all on the goal line with their overly padded friends. He says, hey, I gave you those hands. I gave you that arm. I gave you the eyes. I gave you the balance. I gave you the lungs. I gave it all. Would you just look up and say, thank you, God? Thank you, Joel, brother. He's on top of it. While mankind stands and cheers for some piece of, you know, the average human being's only about $3 worth of chemicals. Really? You take all the water out of you, you're just a pile of chemicals. Some of you bigger pile than others, but it's still not much. And some gal or guy is singing their song in front of the hordes of young people, or they're in Nashville with their long gray hair, and they think, man, cut your hair. You look like a street person, man. And the crowds are applauding them. God lets them get all those accolades. He didn't have to do that. He's Lord. Any day they don't acknowledge God's power and his glory, he could squish them out of existence. Jesus lets the earthly monarchs and tyrants, he lets them rule, while the king allowed people to spit on him, while the king allowed people to mock him. And all that he did was so you could get saved. Jesus' only crowd, they didn't applaud, they cried out, crucify him. They didn't stand and cheer or fall down in worship. They laughed at him. Can't even imagine mocking a horrible, evil person. I mean, take the worst criminal you can think of. It's probably a politician. And picture that person stripped naked and beaten until the flesh was hanging off and their blood was pouring. Have their beard pulled out and them mockingly hung before society on a cross. Could you laugh at that? I don't care who it is, I couldn't laugh at it. They did that to Jesus. Because there was a moment in history when God took all of our sin and put it all on him. And all the hurt and all the wrong and all the shame and all the evil is all dumped on Jesus. That's a Savior. Nobody else loves you that much. And then we sit with our young people and say, kids, you got to get a college degree. Young people, you got to make lots of money. Maybe we ought to make Jesus happy. Get a job, pay your bills. If you go to work somewhere, get there early, work the whole time you're there. Don't take off early, work your whole shift. Do what the boss says, do it their way, go the extra mile, do a better job. And at the end of the day, just say, God, I want to please you. All that he did for us. If I could just this morning consider him, look over to, that's point one. Look at chapter 12. Honest, I'm done, really. Look at chapter 12. In verse 3, Hebrews 12, if you close your Bible, don't worry about it, I'll read it. For consider him that endured such contradiction of sinners against himself. A contradiction is this says one thing and this says another. It's kind of like calling the little things that run around my house a dog. That's a contradiction. When the cats in the neighborhood are bigger than the dog, don't call it a dog. And over here is the Holy Lamb of God. Perfect. He never one time had to apologize. He never one time had to ask forgiveness for a wrong thought. He never one time had to excuse himself for being inappropriate. And then we treat him like a dirty old sinner. That is a contradiction. And what does he say there in Hebrews 12:3? Consider him that endured such contradiction, lest ye be weary and faint in your mind. You know why you shouldn't quit on God? Because he didn't quit on you. You know why you should get saved? Because it's a stupid thing to not get saved. You should get saved because you owe him. You owe it to God to get saved. You owe a debt that you will never pay in 10,000 years. You couldn't. You could suffer in hell for 10,000 years and never yet pay your sin debt. I mean, most of you, I'd be willing to guess that you'd say you're honest. Well, you've got a debt. Your sin and my sin has a debt upon us that we could never pay back in a million years. Put your faith in Christ and your debt is paid. That's a good deal. But not only should you put your faith in Christ, you shouldn't quit on him. Consider him. Consider him that endured such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest you be weary and faint. Can I just tell you, you've got a great God. You've got a great Savior. The shepherds came in our Sunday school lesson this morning. The shepherds came to that little stable and bowed before the Savior and worshiped him. We've got a Savior. Man, love him. He loved you. He gave his life for you. You ought to get up every morning saying, what a God. What an amazing God. We ought to give him all the credit and all the glory. That child, many of you have children, look at that child and say, God made this child. What a miracle. What a blessing. My wife's still putting up with me. What a Savior. The song says, oh, come, let us adore him. He deserves a lot more love than he gets. He's a wonderful, wonderful Savior. And he waits today to not only save you, but also to work with you, serving him. You try to do anything for God, God will jump right in and say, hey, let me help you with that. He loves you. Let's pray. Father, help us today to not forget Jesus. What a Savior. What a Savior. No other religion. No other idea of science could compare with a Savior that we have. I'd ask you to remind us, Lord, help us to consider, help us to think about you, to think about all the garbage you put up with and all the meanness you put up with and all the dirty talk and shameful actions, and you did all that because of a deep love you have for us. There's someone here not saved, Lord, they have a debt they'll never pay, not in a million years. They couldn't pay their debt. They owe it to you. They owe you to pay their debt of sin, and Jesus is willing to do it for them. I pray you'd help them to trust you today. And for those who are saved, I pray, Lord, that you'd help all of us to remember you. Help us to press on. Help us to serve you. May we not grow weary in well-doing. For in due season we will reap if we faint not. Help our workers, bless them, strengthen them for the task before them. Help our parents trying to pay the bills and raise the children and keep things on track. Help them to not grow weary of a God so good. Bless us and help us. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand for just a moment with our heads bowed. Just take a moment alone. Would you tell him you love him? Would you tell him thank you as the instruments play? Consider.